standing, I would like to welcome up Pastor Tony Samuels.
Hallelujah. God is in the house. Woo! You can be seated. Amen. Welcome to Friday Night Glory Service. Let's get out those Bibles and get right into the Word. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Amen. I'd like to thank Bishop and Pastor Allison for the awesome opportunity to minister tonight. Hebrews chapter 11. Let's take a look at this familiar scripture in verse number 6. Hebrews 11, 6. It says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, just thank you for the awesome opportunity to minister your word tonight. And Father God, I ask in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you will give me the words of wisdom, the words of knowledge, the words of understanding. Father God, that you will give me utterance to open my mouth boldly and speak as you would have me to speak. Father God, I pray that the people tonight will hear your voice and my voice. Father God, I pray that this body will be edified, built up, strengthened, refreshed, revived in the inner man like never before. Holy Spirit, have your way. Use this word to speak into people's lives, speak into their situations, speak into their circumstances. Father, I thank you for what you're going to do in advance in Jesus' name. If you believe it, say amen. 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 He's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. You know, we were in my office today, and somebody was brought up the subject of discipleship. And they were saying that there's thank God that God did not just save them, or they just did not have a salvation experience, but that God moved them from salvation into training to become a disciple of Jesus Christ. You know, Jesus said to go into the world and preach the gospel to all nations, all creatures. But then he said, make disciples of all men. You know, I praise God for discipleship, because without discipleship, even though I had a salvation experience, I would not know how to live a victorious Christian life. How many people know that sometimes you're not always going to have a good day? Sometimes things are going to get rough. Sometimes things are not going to go according to the way you plan. What discipleship does, it prepares you for those life events when life, listen, hits you, or life does not turn out the way that you, listen, are believing for it to turn out, and you don't, listen, say, just blow the whole deal and resort back to the old life that God delivered you from. No, discipleship will train you, will teach you how to respond accurately to life when life throws blows at you and you won't blow the whole deal. So I praise God for discipleship, that, listen, that God was willing to not just save me, but take me through a process of learning his word, teaching me his word, and not only learning and sitting up under a teaching ministry, but also giving me, listen, real life opportunities to apply the word of God in my life. That the word was not just taught by a man, but God actually orchestrated divine events to give me the opportunity to walk out the word that I was being taught. So discipleship is an important part, listen, of our Christian experience. Now, one of the word that I wanted to focus on in that opening scripture was, it says he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. I want to focus on tonight on the word diligently. That God is a God that, listen, is looking for diligence in our walk with him, that he's not a God of a one-time deal. He's not a God, a 30-day God. He's not an 18-month God. No, God is looking for a long-term relationship with you, not a 30-day deal, not an 18-month deal. God wants long-term relationship with you until he takes you home to be with him. But it's going to take an ingredient that you need in your Christian life, and the ingredient is you must be an individual that is diligent. Diligent means constant in effort to accomplish something, attentive and persistent in doing anything. Constant, earnest effort to accomplish what's undertaken, persistent exertion of body and mind. So listen, God is looking for diligence on our behalf, that we will be consistent in our walk with the Lord, that we won't be an up and down Christian. One day I'm serving him, the next day I'm not. No, but I'm consistent in my walk with God. That, listen, I'm serving God today, I'm serving God the next day, I'm serving God next year, I'm serving God 5 years, 20 years from now. Listen, in good times, bad times, when the sun is shining, when the sun's not shining, when the check came in the mail or the check didn't come in the mail, that I will still be consistent in my relationship with the Lord. Not just trying God out, but I can be an individual that can be counted on in my walk with the Lord. God is looking for consistency. It's time out for lackadaisy, just a fair weather Christian, that I'll do it if I feel good, and if I don't feel good, I'm going to pack up and I'm going somewhere else. No, God is looking for consistency. That, listen, you can count on me. You know the Bible says many are called, but few are chosen. Who are the chosen? The chosen are the ones that show up. That constantly show up. Many are called, but who's constantly showing up? Many are called. Many people, I got a calling on my life. All right, that's good. Let me see you. Let's, all right. I got a calling on my life. All right, take this broom and go sweep. What? But it was a calling to preach. No, you're going to start right here, and we're going to develop some consistency in your life before we put you up in front of people and you listen, get crazy and blow the whole deal. God's going to see if you can be diligent. Listen, when nobody's looking, before he puts you up in front of everybody when everybody's looking. Man, I had a calling to do this. Let's see you be diligent sweeping. Let's see you be diligent with the things that nobody sees. Let's see you be diligent in the nursery. Let's see you be diligent with ushering. Let's see if you'll be diligent without the spotlight. Everybody's diligent when the spotlight is shining. You take the spotlight off and diligence goes out the window. God is looking for diligence with the spotlight and without the spotlight. Diligence is an action word. In Proverbs 10:4, it says, he becometh poor that dealeth with the slack hand, but the hand of the diligent maketh rich. Let's read that again. You can write these down because I'm going to be zooming. Proverbs 10:4, he becometh. It's Friday Night Glory. He becometh poor that dealeth with a slack hand, but the hand of the diligent maketh rich. The slack hand is the opposite of diligent. Slack means not tight, not firm, not tense, loose, negligent, careless, slow, sluggish, not active or busy, moving very slowly. So listen, the one that deals with a slack hand becomes poor, but the hand of the diligent maketh rich. I don't know about you, but I never seen anybody that's not diligent prosper. It's usually the one that's on point, on target, doing what he's supposed to do. Listen, that's going to, listen, attract the riches of God in his life. He's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. God is looking for diligence. But God, I've been serving you for 7 days. Where is it at? I've been tithing for 30 days. Where is it at? The Lord is looking for diligence. Keep on doing it. Keep on doing it. When you don't see it, when you see it, keep on doing it. Listen, if you're waiting, it's because God is, listen, developing the character trait of diligence on the inside of you. He can give it to you just like that. But God is more concerned about character development than you just receiving the blessing that he has. Because character, the right character, will be able to hold and maintain and keep what the Lord has for your life. You won't blow the deal. When you are slack in the way you handle things in your life, it will lead you straight to poverty. Try slacking off on the job. Try just not doing nothing at work. And what's going to happen? You're going to lose your job. And then what's going to be the result of that? Poverty. But when you are diligent, your life flows into the direction of abundance. You actually begin to attract abundance. You begin to actually attract abundance when you're a man or woman that's diligent. In Proverbs 13:4, listen to this. It says, the soul of the sluggard desires and has nothing, but the soul of the diligent shall be made fat. Let me read it again. The soul of the sluggard desires and has nothing, but the soul of the diligent shall be made fat. The sluggard, or the man or woman that's not diligent, is in a rough situation because that individual has desires, but because they're slothful and slack, they walk around with unfulfilled desires. But listen, when you're diligent, you won't only have desires. God will make sure that those desires come to pass in your life. He's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he'll give you the desires of your heart. But God is looking at your diligence. Man, he's showing up. Okay, she's showing up. Man, consistent, consistent, consistent. Man, I know they're going through hell, but they're still consistent. They're still showing up. I'm still showing up. And listen, God is looking at that. And listen, you keep your eyes on a man or woman that's being diligent and consistent, not murmuring and complaining and blaming and doing all this other crazy foolishness. You keep your eyes on it, because it's only a matter of time before the blessings of God in Deuteronomy 28 begin to overtake them, because he said that those that diligently hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, all these blessings will come upon them and overtake them when they are diligent in the things of God. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he'll give you the desires of your heart. You know, sometimes you got to stir yourself up. Sometimes feelings will try to overtake you. Feelings of slothfulness, feelings of oppression, feelings of depression, feelings and thoughts of negativity sometimes begin to try to overtake your life, and you don't even realize you're up under a spiritual attack. And you need to recognize that's not from God, and you need to stir yourself up and stir up the power of God in your life to override those feelings and those emotions that try to rise up in your life to stop your flow of diligence. Negativity. You were happy yesterday, but today it's like it's gone. Then you find yourself going through a week walking like that. You're under an attack, and you need to stir yourself up and say, the devil is a liar. The joy of the Lord is my strength. And listen, I will be happy. I will be content. I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. I will. I will. I make a decision, not about how I feel. I will bless the Lord. And make a decision to bless God. It's got nothing to do with, but you know how many times I don't feel like coming to church? How many times I don't feel like praying? How many times I don't feel like reading the Bible? But I don't let that stop me. I make myself do it. Yeah. Discipleship training, you make yourself do it. Disciple, a disciplined one. It's nothing to do with feelings. Override feelings with the power of God on the inside of you. Forget feelings. Whew. I get to the gym. God rewards diligence. Go to Deuteronomy 11. God is speaking to some people. He's saying, come on, man, get diligent. Stop slacking. Stop getting slothful. Stop getting lazy. Get your butt in gear. Get with the program. Your life is on the line. Deuteronomy 11, let's look at verse 13. Diligent. Listen, the time we live in, it ain't no time to be playing church. Listen, the time the devil is doing crazy stuff in the world. It's not time to play church. It's time to get on fire for God for real. Forget all that other stuff and get on fire. Forget what's going on the outside of you. Deal with what's going on the inside of you. Say, God, ignite a fire on the inside of me, a fire that won't go out. Forget all that stuff on the outside. God, work on me. Faith home, the time is ticking. Before you know it, it'll be time to put it into practice. The time is now, but listen, the rubber will meet the road, and you can't let the clock, listen, strike. The time is time to go, and you've been playing games. You've been coasting through. No, you got to make sure you've been applying yourself to the Word of God, that you're allowing the Holy Spirit and God's leadership to disciple you in the things of God so you may be rooted and grounded in the things of God so when the storms of life hit, you don't get blown away. That's what it's about. You know when your root system is being built? In the rough times. When you don't feel like serving God. When you don't feel like doing. That's when God is doing it. When you don't see anything going on the outside of you. He's not working over here. He's developing a root system on the inside of you. And if you could see what was going on in your spiritual life, you would cooperate with the Lord. And not resist him and not fight him. You would cooperate with the Lord and say, God, do what you got to do. Root me and ground me in the things, in the Holy Ghost, in your word, in the things of the Spirit. I don't want the storms of life to blow and I get blown away. Listen, if I got to go, if you wanted me to walk through the fire, through the heat, but at the same time, simultaneously, you're developing a root system, so do it, Lord. And let him develop you into the man, into the woman that he's called you to be. I know it can get rough. I know you feel like running, but don't run. Stay in it. Stay in the oven. I know it's hot. I know you're looking out the oven and saying, when is this thing going to be up? Stay in the oven. You know what happens to stuff that comes out of the oven too early? You know what happens to a cake that comes out the oven too early, that's looking good, smelling good, but has not been in there long enough? You pull that thing out before it's time, and it flops right on its face. And that's what happens. Sometimes we jump out of the things of God too fast, and we look good, we're smelling good, and we think we're walking, we think we're strong, but listen, you have not developed on the inside. And then when you step out of that oven into the elements, you can't handle it, and you fall flat on your face. It's real. You are engaged in a real walk with God. This is not how my grandmother taught me in Sunday school. This is past that. This is a real relationship with God, with the Father, and God the Father working with the Holy Spirit to disciple you, to train you into things of the Spirit. And listen, listen, through, you can just look back over your life and look at all the hell that God has brought your life through, and you're still here on Friday night, 2016, praising the Lord. Look at your name and say, I'm still here. By the grace of God. See, if the devil could have had his way, he would have wiped you out a long time ago. You would not be here. You would not even be in the conversation if it was up to the enemy. But God's hand on your life carried you through the fire and the storm. And even when you felt like giving up, he snatched you through it all and put your feet on a solid ground, solid foundation. Can't be moved or shaken. You know what? You're right. Because before God, I would have got blown all over the place. I would have been like a leaf. Where's it going to land now? Where's it going to land? Controlled by the storms and the winds of life. But now the storms may blow. Listen, the rain may come. All this stuff may come. You may be bending down to feel like you're about to snap and lose it. And listen, God is still holding you, and you're still able to maintain through that storm, and you're still standing straight in the things of God. Did I read that Deuteronomy? Oh, God took off. Okay, Deuteronomy 11. Verse 13, listen to this. And it shall come to pass, if you hearken diligently unto the commandments which I command you this day, to love the Lord your God, to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, that I will give you the rain of your land in due season, the first rain and the latter rain, that you may gather in thy corn, thy wine, and thy oil, and I will send grass in your fields for your cattle, that you may eat and be full. So look at this. The prerequisite for all of that good stuff happening started in verse 13. It shall come to pass if you hearken diligently unto the Lord. If you are diligent, all these blessings will begin to come on your life and overtake you. Look at your neighbor and say, you know what? I realize it's only a matter of time. What you're believing God for, it's only a matter of time. If you can remain diligent and consistent and walk through seasons and walk and beat the clock, take a licking and keep on ticking, listen, God will bring to pass what you're believing for. Just remain diligent, consistent. Don't give up. Stay in the fight. Luke 9:62, Jesus said unto them, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Write it down. Luke 9:62, Jesus said, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. He said, once you put your hand to the plow, keep on plowing. Don't stop plowing. Don't look back. Keep on plowing until the job is done. What is Jesus dealing with? He's saying, guys, I don't want you to start something. I don't want you to put your hands in this thing. I don't want you to begin this thing and then turn back. Listen, away from the course, the destination that I had your life on. Even though you may look like you were plowing and you hit a rock, don't look like you can overcome it. He's saying, don't look back. Don't take your hands off the plow. I will bring you through that mess. Just don't look back. Be diligent in the things of God. A lot of people get infatuated with the plow. Wow, look at that nice, shiny plow. A lot of people want to use that plow on the field. But when they start plowing, they realize, hey, wait a minute. This is hard work. When is break time? As a matter of fact, when is quitting time? They want to take a break and not come back. Jesus is saying, do not start something and don't finish it, Christian. Let me say that again. Jesus is saying, do not start something and then don't finish it, Christian. It's time to operate in a spirit of excellence. It's time to commit and not change. It's time to get the job done. But we got to be diligent. We got to be diligent, whether we feel like it or not. I'm telling you, if you begin to deal with those feelings and do it, not because I feel like it, but do it because it's right, eventually it's going to become natural after a while that I'm just programmed to do it right. Even when I don't feel like it, character is developed so much strong on the inside of me. I'm going to do it whether I feel like it or not, whether everybody's doing it or not. I got to do it. I got to work out my own salvation with fear and trembling before the Lord. I got to walk this thing out. Thank God for my brothers and my sister, but I got to walk this thing out. I can't live inside you. I don't know how you're feeling. You know how you're feeling, and you got to deal with that, man. It's time to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the things of the Lord. Galatians 6:9 says, don't grow weary in well-doing, for in due season you will reap if you faint not. Now go to 1 Kings 18. 1 Kings 18. Diligence, consistency, the prerequisite for God's blessing coming on your life. 1 Kings 18. Let's take a look at verse 41. 1 Kings 18, verse 41. Y'all got it? All right, let's go. Verse 41. And Elijah said unto Ahab, somebody say Ahab, get thee up, eat and drink, for there's a sound of an abundance of rain. So Ahab went up to eat and to drink. And Elijah went up to the top of Carmel, and he cast himself down upon the earth and put his face between his knees. And he said to his servant, go up now, look toward the sea. And he went up and looked and said, there is nothing. And he said, go again seven times. Somebody say seven times. Verse 44, and it came to pass at the seventh time that he said, behold, there arises a little cloud out of the sea like a man's hand. He said, go up and say unto Ahab, prepare thy chariot and get thee down that the rain stop thee not. Elijah heard something in his spirit. He heard the sound of rain, even though it had not rained in a long time. He said, man, I hear the sound of rain. And he sent his servant to look to see if the rain was coming on the horizon. And listen, he did not see it. And he came back and said, there's nothing. He said, there's nothing. Elijah said to him, Elijah realized, you know what? This guy ain't diligent. Because I know if I tell him to go again, I'm going to have to tell him to go again and again. Hey, buddy, go seven times. It was because of the servant's diligence that he finally seen what the prophet had heard in his spirit. And I use that point to say this, that listen, even though the word of faith comes and faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God, whether of here or God spoke it to you directly into your spirit. If you, and you know you heard God and you say, oh my God, I'm about to get that job. Oh, my God, I'm about to get restored to my family. God just spoke to me. But listen, if you don't possess the ingredient of diligence, you'll walk outside and not see anything and then begin to question what you heard. No, you got to come outside that day. You got to come outside the next day. You got to come outside the next day and keep on coming outside, because listen, the devil is a liar. The truth is what you heard. But listen, if you do not possess diligence, you will not hang around long enough to see what the Lord wants to bring in your life. You will continue to live in a drought when God had rain prepared for your life, because you left before the time. Diligence was the thing that paid off and got the man from hearing to seeing. Diligence will take you from hearing to seeing. But if you don't possess diligence, you'll always be somebody that hears and hears and hears and goes here and there and there and never sees it show up in your life, because you never hang around long enough to see the promise of God come to pass. Then he said, being tossed around with every wind of doctrine, tossed around here and there, tossed around to and fro, because you won't remain diligent and consistent. Look at your neighbor and say, God is not a schizophrenic. If God told you something to do, don't come back and tell me a week later, oh, this is a new plan that came up. Wait a minute. Somebody got it wrong. Somebody's missing it. And listen, it's not God. Elijah heard the sound of an abundance of rain. His diligence took him from hearing to seeing. In Proverbs 12:24, the Bible says, the hand of the diligent will rule, but the slothful will be put to forced labor. Proverbs 12:24 says, the hand of the diligent will rule, but the slothful will be put to forced labor. Diligence will put you on top in your life. A lack of diligence will put you on the bottom of life. You know what's going to happen to your life if you say, you know what, I ain't going to work. Forget it. I'm just going to sit here on the TV. All right? Maybe you got away with it one day. All right, man. They calling you now, 2 days. Where you at? 3 days, you're out. So, all right, you're sitting there. Keep on sitting there. Eventually, the bills are going to start coming. Eventually, they're going to have a due date on them. And keep on sitting until them due dates come around and see what happens to your circumstances. You will be sitting in the house of darkness because you let slothfulness take over your life. You better get out and work and be diligent. And listen, attract the wealth of God. The hand of the diligent will rule, but the slothful will be put to forced labor. Now, when I think of somebody powerful in the Bible that was so diligent, I always think of the man Joshua. Joshua, that was a man that was diligent in the things of God. I know he had to be diligent because, remember, he was with the guys that went over to the promised land and said that we can take it, and then 10 guys said we can't. And because of a bunch of unbelievers, he had to wait for 40 years waiting around with doubters, but somehow he did not let their unbelieving spirit rub off on him. 40 years he was in the desert, holding on to the word of God, the promise of God, surrounded by over 1 million people that did not believe the promise of God and had to walk out their sentence until they were out of the picture before he could go over into the promised land. And we know that when the day came for Joshua to come into the promised land, it was not like God had to stir him up. Joshua said, come on, let's do it. We can take the land. We could have took it 40 years ago, but we're going to take it today. He still was diligent in the things of God. Over 40 years holding on to the word of God for his life. Look at your neighbor and say, thank God I ain't got to wait 40 years. Whew. course, when he got into the promised land, God told him how to maintain success was to meditate on the word day and night. He told him to be diligent with the things of the spirit. And if he did, he would have consistent success in the natural realm. Now, that's interesting because actually diligence is a byproduct of something that you're doing. Your diligence that everybody's seeing is a byproduct of something that you're doing that nobody's seeing. Diligence that's being seen is, listen, the result of something that's not being seen. The people that are diligent are the people that are seeking the Lord, people that are in his word, people that have a relationship with God, and with the manifestation of that is a diligent, productive life. When the disciples were looking for men to take care of tables, the first qualification they said, choose us out men that are full of faith and full of the Holy Ghost and power. We want guys not just to be here working. We want guys that's got a relationship with the Lord, because we know if that's intact, they're going to serve us right. That was the qualification. It wasn't a degree. Are they of faith and are they full of the Holy Ghost? I don't care about the degree. What's on the inside of you? Now, in Joshua 6, we're almost done. In Joshua 6, first city that they get to is a place called Jericho. God told Joshua in Joshua 6, I have given you the city of Jericho. But with the giving of the city, God gave Joshua special instructions to receive what has already been given. Look at your neighbor and say, I already got it. But I got to obey the instructions. The instructions God gave, you already got it, but you got to obey the instructions. You already got it. Come to church. You already got it. Sit up under the lighthouse. You already got to come to the faith home. Obey the instructions to receive what God has already given. The power is not in the instructions. The power is in our obedience to the instructions. No matter how crazy his instructions may be, God told Joshua to march around the city one time a day for 6 days, and on the seventh day, go around the city seven times, and on the seventh time, let the trumpets blast, then let the people shout and watch those walls come tumbling down. Let's think about it for a second. It's easy to read it on paper, but you got to put yourself in the equation. March around a city for 7 days? Come on, we would struggle with walking around the perimeter of this property for 7 days. God is telling these people to walk around a city for 7 days. I didn't study out the dimensions of the city, but I'm sure it was big. So he marched around the city for 7 days. I wonder what was going through those people's mind as they carried out those instructions. Joshua, are you sure you heard from the Lord? Probably on that third day, probably like, is this guy really hearing from God? God is out here walking around this city, man. I mean, telling us on the seventh day, this is going to happen. Did this guy really hear from God? Sometimes you'll say that when God got you in an instruction and going around, did I really hear from God? Man, this is getting kind of monotonous. Did I really hear from the Lord? Yeah, you heard from him. Keep on marching. Look at your neighbor and say, keep on marching. Yes, keep on marching. Be careful when you're doing something for God. You don't let your mind talk you out of it. And on the second day, you decide that this is foolishness and I don't want to do it anymore. Carry out the instructions until the end, and watch the walls come tumbling down. They carried out the instructions of God, and because of that, they took the whole city. for obeying the instruction of God. But the thing in that instruction was you had to be diligent. 7 days walking around, consistent. 7 days walking around the city. I'm telling you, some of us would struggle 7 times walking around this. A city, guys. Keep doing it. 18 months. Keep doing it. Keep doing it. Listen, keep doing it. Keep doing it. Keep doing it. One more example, then we're done. Let's go to, man, I didn't even mark that scripture down. You guys know the story of Naaman, a man named Naaman who was a military man who was, the Bible called him a leper. And Naaman wanted an instantaneous miracle. I mean, all of us, I'd rather have an instantaneous miracle. I'd rather not walk around this thing 7 days. I mean, instantaneous would be a lot. One, can we cut it to 1 day? You know, or half the city or some, can we reduce it? Anyways, he wanted an instantaneous. I don't blame him. But listen, be careful that you don't dictate to the Lord how he's going to bless you. He did not like the instruction that was given him. Basically, the instruction was for him to go dip in the Jordan River 7 times. And at that time, the Jordan was not the pristine, plush place to be dipping. He's like, why didn't he choose the Nile River? Why did he choose this river? Don't ask questions, just do it. Let me say that again. Don't ask the questions. Why didn't he choose that river? Don't worry about it. Just do what he said. Don't ask questions. All right, I got it. Okay, he told him to dip in the Jordan 7 times, and if you do it, you'll be clean of your leprosy. So finally, he said, you know what? What I got to lose? I'm going for it. I'm going to obey this crazy instruction, and I'm going to go dip 7 times in this river. Probably make sure nobody ain't looking. 7 times. Get them. But listen, on that 7th time, the man with leprosy came out whole. Amen. Looking sharp. Who cares what the instructions is if you come out whole? If you come out blessed, just do it. Who cares about the instruction? I'm looking for the end product. Don't focus so much on the instructions and the process of God that you lose sight of the end product. You lose sight of why you even begun to believe him. You're so engaged in the instruction and what's going on that you've lost sight of why you've even started. And the Lord is saying, don't get inundated with the instruction and all these questions going through your heart and your mind. Remember why you did it. You had enough faith to start it. You got enough faith to finish. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. Amen. But listen, LRC. Be diligent in the things of God. Don't be a one-time, 30-day, 1 month. When it comes to tithing or giving, don't try it out. It's got to become a lifestyle. Be like, man, I'm going to do it whether it shows up or not, because that's my life. That's my lifestyle. I'm a believer. Amen? Amen. Amen. I'm finished. Hallelujah. Woo! Amen. Before we close, we always want to give the opportunity for prayer. Or maybe you're here tonight and you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. We want to give you the opportunity tonight, if you have not made that decision, to be bold and step up here publicly and make him your Lord. Best decision you'll ever make. Or if you're here tonight and you need prayer for, maybe you got a sickness you're dealing with, maybe you got a financial situation, maybe you need strength to continue. Maybe you've been slacking and diligent. You say, man, I need God's power to continue. You know, that's a good prayer. God, give me strength to continue. Jesus said, listen, if you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. But sometimes we need strength to continue. I'm asking the prayer team to come on up. And if you need prayer tonight, we welcome you to come now and receive from your Lord.
Atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. The atmosphere is changing. The Spirit of the Lord.
depths of our heart tonight.
Fire burning again.
Hallelujah. Y'all ready to be diligent? Amen. Let's give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Sunday morning, Youth Sunday. Amen. Men, 9 o'clock. Amen. Come on, let's show them. Amen. Amen. Let's lift our hands up to the Lord. Father, we just declare the blessing over your people tonight. Father, bless them going in. Bless them coming out. Ephesians 3:20, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Amen. Be blessed. Thank you.